What does a piece of ground signify? Place to mow? Place to build? Place to call home? Place to worship? This piece of ground has supported children playing games during vacation Bible school, surrounded families as they played together, provided a piece of stability for a meal and fellowship. This piece of ground did not always look this way. Other buildings occupied this land. People who were not with us today put in their blood, sweat, and tears to make it viable. Other people who now sit with God in a heavenly realm claimed this rich earth. They gave of their time, their gifts, their energy, and their hard-earned dollars to establish something significant here. Since 1888, this piece of ground has transformed from dirt to grass, to concrete, to masonry and brick, and to building after building after building. But since 1888, the people of God have witnessed some great things here. Weddings, baptisms, revivals, celebrations, puppet shows, moments for learning, and funerals, and tragedies, and times of grief. It is what the church is supposed to be, a place of sharing Christ through our faith and our actions. Thank you for joining us for today's worship. Over the next few minutes, you will see some of the highlights of our ministries. And then, we will worship the God who has been here with the people for 133 years and for another 133 years to come. Good morning.
Good morning.
I welcome you to, the change of the seasons. And if you think about it, tomorrow it's November, and so it's time for yucky weather to come. But we welcome you to our time here this morning, and also those on the live stream. This morning is the fifth Sunday of October. It is the last Sunday that we're lifting up our sermon series called Life Changing Lessons. And we have been marching through a song out of the Faith We Sing hymn book called Blessed Quietness. And this morning we're going to sing verse 5. And if you are comfortable to stand, would you please stand as we sing this last verse?
Lives, God is with us.
Praise be to God for God's mercy and love.
Even when we are faced with difficult decisions, God's presence is near.
We don't know which way to go. God will guide and lead us.
Open your hearts today to God's gently leading.
We open our lives to God, that we may faithfully serve God all our days. Amen.
Praise to the Lord the Almighty, hymn number 139.
Thank you.
gather now for a ritual of friendship. This is our opportunity to say hi, good morning, hello to those gathered around us. And one of the things that we like to do, since we are streaming live, is take that opportunity as you say hello to everyone around you, also to wave those on the camera. So, and after you've done so, you may all be seated. So good morning.
Good morning,
good morning.
Good morning
to you. And after you've had an opportunity to say hello to those gathered around, you may all be seated.
Okay.
Want to thank the ushers handing out the attendance pads. This just lets us know of your record of attendance. And the first thing I want to lift up, Cherry has a survey. So if you were here last week, you were already aware of this, is we are looking for a time as to when our Christmas Eve service is. So we would like you to fill out this survey, and it's one per person, not one per family, one per person. And just raise your hand if you need a Christmas Eve survey. So go ahead and hand those out. We've got some folks here. And I'll grab some, help you out here. There we go. Yeah. And so what we're requesting here is, we need some more there, is just put down your first, second, and third choice. And so once we have, Cherry, I think we need some over for this family over here. So once you've had an opportunity to let us know, this week we will tally all the hand one up at the front, and we will get all of the material ordered. We're just going to this year we're going to have one service. One of the questions that was brought up was about the living nativity, and those of you that are not aware, last year because of COVID restrictions, we decided to have the Christmas have a living nativity for Christmas Eve. So this year we are going to do the living nativity. However, it will be at another time. It will not be on Christmas Eve. So we will have our traditional Christmas Eve service here in the sanctuary, and then we will then announce as to one of the other evenings that we will have the living nativity. We just haven't figured that out yet. The main thing is we need to find out what time you would like to have our Christmas Eve service. So as I said, just mark down first, second, and third choice, and this week we'll get that information out. I'm just checking the live stream information. One of the things to always mention is we do have several ways for you to get your announcements, prayer concerns, and joys to us. You can text them to me. I do have access to email, and then also through our Facebook Live, just to see if there is any announcements here. And so there is a little bit of a delay, and so that might come in a little bit even after the announcement time. Also, the insert, you see the information about Daryl Burton. And this, he has a very powerful story. He is a United Methodist pastor serving right now at our largest church in the conference down in Kansas City. He was wrongly convicted of a murder and spent 18 years in prison. He has now been exonerated. And so he speaks of forgiveness and grace. He will be here this week. And then Friday night at 7, we're hosting at the Scotts Bluff Church because that's the largest United Methodist Church in the county. And it is also going to be live streamed. But we invite you to somehow hear his story. And that's going to be this Friday night. There is also, you see on the brochure that is handed out to you, also opportunities to visit with him in person, but the main event is really going to be this Friday night. And then one final thing on the calendar is just to mention on Saturday is our charge conference, which will also be held at Scotts Bluff. That's at 10 a.m., so that's this Saturday. I'd like to turn it over to you for your joys, concerns, announcements, prayers. Maybe you have a birthday or anniversary that you need to be lifted up. Yes, Sarah.
Just prayers for the Angle family. They lost
So look. Okay, thank you. So for those that didn't hear the announcement, this is the Kim Engel, who my wife worked with at Panhandle Public Health. Her son, some of you saw in the newspaper, lost their home in the fire on Thursday night. And when Sarah reached out to her former coworker, they were able to grab one photo item, and that was it before the whole place went engulfed in flames. So lift them up in our prayers, and that you will be hearing about a fund that will be available to help them out. So thank you, Sarah. Yes, Roger. And Jennifer's birthday is tomorrow, so we've got at least one birthday to be sung here this morning. Yes. And Dawn has a birthday tomorrow as well, so we've got a couple of special birthdays lifting up. Other sharing here this morning. Let me just check the information in the live stream. All right, well, let's go ahead and sing Happy Birthday. Just received this information. So this week we were informed that Becky Kautz's mom got COVID. And so I just got this note from Chris. Becky Kautz's mom is out of the hospital with COVID and back to her assisted living residence, doing better. But then he does say Ike, that is Aaron's husband, tested positive for COVID. Prayers for Ike and Aaron. So we definitely lift them up in our prayer thoughts here this morning. So, and congratulations, you got out of the cast, and so just in time for trick or treat for Halloween. So congratulations. Any other sharing here this morning?
Oh, Kathy.
Yes, Kathy. Yeah, prayers for a smooth transition. It doesn't sound like it's smooth, and didn't hear the details. The moving truck is in one place. Your daughter is not here when she should be here. I mean, all these things that should be happening. So, yeah, so, well, I'm so sorry. Others? Well, seeing no others, at this time, I invite our children to come forward for our children's time. Well, I welcome all of you. Traffic cone, that's right. We'll get started here in just a second when everyone's up here. All right, so why don't you come up here and check out this traffic cone here. So everyone come on up to the chance. Come on up. Gather around this traffic cone here. Come up. Come here. Bring your brother. There you go. Help you out. There we go. All right. So, what are traffic cones for?
They're to stop traffic.
To stop traffic. So it's like obviously you're not driving yet, but maybe if you're on a bike, you see the traffic cone, it's like, oh, okay, I better stop. What also is a traffic cone good for? What?
Blocking
off places that you're not supposed to go. That's right. Any others? Is it like a warning?
Yeah.
Maybe if it was like, here, excuse me here, I'm going to put it over. Say it's off on the side of the road, and you kind of see this as like, oh, okay, maybe something is going on over here. All right, so. If there's caution tape in there, that's right, there might be an emergency, but just. Yeah, and your dad knows all about that too, because he, I bet, uses these traffic cones a lot.
I saw some because I saw caution tape and a bunch of them and fire trucks.
Yeah. Oh yeah. You see these all the time. So one of the things I want to tell you about. Come here. So we're in the Bible. There's two things I want you to be really clear about. Now if you see this right here, I want you, have you ever heard anyone ever say, you are bad? You are bad. Yes. Here's the thing. You were not bad. Now, maybe you've done a bad thing. Maybe you've done something that you weren't supposed to do. But here's the deal. You are not bad. You've just done something bad. It's kind of like this traffic cone. I want you to think of it as kind of a warning. You know, when you see this traffic cone, it's like, whoa, oh, we got to watch out for this. I might do something bad. But here's the deal. You are not bad. And here's the reason why. I want you to repeat this with me. Are you ready? Are you ready to repeat something? I want you to say, I am worthy. So put those three words together. I am worthy. All right, say it one more time. I am worthy. Say it one more time.
I am worthy.
That's right. God loves you. And you might do something bad. You might have this traffic cone as a warning sign, but you were not bad. God loves you. Jesus loves you. Why? Okay, repeat it one more time. I am worthy. Because God loves you so much, and there's nothing you can do about it. That's what I believe. And oh, and there's cover. Yes, thank you. All right. So we've already done the prayer. So, but we're okay. So just put your hands together and just say, God,
thank you
for loving us. Amen. All right. Oh, wait. One more before you get some candy. Come here. I want you to go over to Jennifer and I want you to say, trick or treat. Smell my feet. Give me something good to eat. All right. Go over there. All right.
Trick or treat.
You gotta take your shoes off.
Smell my feet. Give me something good to eat.
That's disgusting. No.
I don't like mushrooms. I don't like chocolate.
As our kids are being dismissed, we're just checking the
live stream here. Any more information? I invite you now to join me in our prayer of confession. And the words are on the screen. You are able to watch that at home. And it's also in the bulletin. Let us pray this together. How often, O Lord, have we believed that the greatest commandment is our love for ourselves solely? We have not heard the cries of those in need. We have turned our backs on opportunities to serve you by serving others. Many times we have thought only of our own wants and desires and ignored the needs of others. Help us to truly understand the commandments to love you with our heart, soul, strength, and mind. Let us care for our neighbors both far and near. Bring us back to your loving light, for we ask these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us join now in a time of silent prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this moment. We don't always get the time to pray, or we don't make the time to pray. But right now, dear Lord, we are sitting in your spirit, in your time, in this moment, to lift up those that not only on our prayer list here this morning, but those prayers that were spoken out loud. But we know that, gracious God, there are prayers that are left in our hearts. You hear them. You respond to them. You watched over us. Dear Lord, be with us in this mighty moment of your spirit. Be with our children today as they gather in for a night of Halloween, and just allow us to kind of keep an eye out for them so that they can have fun and enjoy themselves and do it safely. Dear Lord, for these prayers and those that we lift up, those that are having a hard time, those that are facing a tough week, those that are seeing some blessings come their way. All of these prayers, gracious God, we lift them up into your mighty name as we pray to you our Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
Amen. Will you join with me as we sing together verse 1 of what wondrous love is this? I want to apologize. I just realized that my microphone was on and the folks at home could hear me singing. So when I edit this and we put it out online, I will make sure that that is somehow taken out. So we don't want you to have that and listen to that. Last week was a heavy lesson. So for those of you that were not here last week, you know that there wasn't much on laughter. Now, I admit that there are people that say the church is no place for comedy, that it should be a place where you seriously and diligently focus on the Lord, and if you break a smile, well, shame on you. There's a problem with that statement, actually, two of them. One is we're not Vulcans. We're not robots. We cannot control our emotions. Feelings of grief and sadness are just as valid as emotions of anger and rage is just as important as happiness and joy. In fact, Jesus talks about that. One of the first books that I read when I was studying religion was a book called The Humor of Christ by Elton Trueblood. And I will never forget this, but he talked about a passage of scripture. One of the first things he said from Matthew 7:5, you hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. He mentioned, Trueblood says of that quote, once we realized that Christ was not always engaged in pious talk, we have made an enormous step on the road to understanding. It's biblical to laugh. In fact, it's downright Christian to see humor and laughter in life and in the church. And with that said, a couple of stories for you. The first one comes from the king of comedians, Mark Twain. One time he told of a friend, they were at the horse races together, and his friend had lost all of his money, and he came up to Twain, and he says, "I am broke. Can you buy me a ticket back to town?" And Twain said, "Well, I'm pretty broke myself, but I'll tell you what, why don't you hide under my seat, and I will cover you with my legs?" And the guy agreed to that. So Mark Twain, he goes up to the ticket office, and he buys two tickets, didn't tell the friend. And when the train was underway, the friend was snug under the seat, and the conductor came by, and Twain gave him two tickets. And the conductor says, "Well, where's the other passenger?" And Twain kind of tapped him on the forehead and said in a loud voice, "This is my friend's ticket. He's a little eccentric. He likes to ride under the seat." Here's another one. This one's my favorite. There was a truck driver that was driving through a large city, and there was nothing unique about this semi-truck or the driver, but every red light, he would stop at the red light, he would get out a baseball bat, and he would just start banging the side of the truck. And this would happen every red light. Well, there was another driver that was noticing this, finally stops and says, "What in the world are you doing?" And the truck driver says, "Well, it's like this. I have a 2-ton truck and I'm carrying 4 tons of canaries. That means I need to keep 2 tons in the air at all times." Kim, did you like that one?
That was good. I did that when I drive the
place. All right, there you go. So if you see Kim hitting the side of his truck, that's why. So, okay, I thought I would kind of lighten things up here a bit for our final lesson, because it really is the opposite of light. Shame is the master emotion. Wow, even that phrase is heavy. A little explanation here. We started this sermon series in the month of October with phrases and quotes that are easy to remember from Brene Brown. Brene can be seen on YouTube, TED Talks, Oprah, Instagram, and Netflix. She has a blog, she's got books. In fact, she is a heavy dose of our Bible study that we have on Tuesdays. And I want to remind you that if you want to watch any of these lessons over again, or if you've missed one of them, just go to our website, click on the worship button, and you'll be able to watch these lessons. Now, this is not an advertisement for Brene Brown. To me, she's just a vessel. It's kind of like what Dave Ramsey says. Dave says that he didn't invent personal finance, he just packaged it well. Now, that's kind of simplifying things. Brene has done her work, and she, I think, is an expert on shame. But before we head down that difficult road, I want to remind you that all of these lessons are all biblical. In fact, the Bible is full of shame stories. But we'll get to that here in a second. Because everything that we do, once we start learning a concept, once we start figuring out a life-changing lesson, we start recognizing it, and we start seeing it and hearing it all around us. That's the Holy Spirit working. That's the Spirit sinking in and trying to convince you of these life-changing lessons. So, would you repeat all of the catchy phrases that we've learned already here in October? Let's say this together. The story I tell myself. Faith is a place of mystery. Setting boundaries. Vulnerability is courage. And shame is the master emotion. As I said, it is found in Scripture. Jennifer?
1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 through 22. Who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you should suffer for doing what is right, how happy are you? Do not be afraid of anyone, and do not worry, but have reverence for Christ in your hearts and honor him as Lord. Be ready at all times to answer anyone who asks you to explain the hope you have in you, but do it with gentleness and respect. Keep your conscience clear so that when you are insulted, those who speak evil of your good conduct as followers of Christ will become ashamed of what they say. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if this should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ died for sins once and for all, a good man on behalf of sinners, in order to lead you to God. He was put to death physically, but made alive spiritually. And in his spiritual existence, he went and preached to the imprisoned spirits. These were the spirits of those who had not obeyed God when he waited patiently during the days that Noah was building his boat. The few people in the boat, eight in all, were saved by the water, which is a symbol pointing to baptism, which now saves you. It is not the washing off of bodily dirt, but the promise made to God from a good conscience. It saves you through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is gone to heaven and is at the right side of God, ruling over all angels and heavenly authorities and powers.
So what is this passage about? Well, this is a lesson on suffering, but not just any suffering. This is suffering for Christ's sake. This is suffering because you and I follow Christ. This is suffering because you and I are doing something different than the rest of society. You know, standing up for your beliefs in Christ, not following a law because it violates your Christian conviction. But I do want to bring some clarity here. Suffering because you are wearing a cross and someone gives you a dirty look is not suffering according to 1 Peter. Suffering because you make a statement on Facebook about your Christian conviction and someone unfriends you or someone is challenging your statement is not suffering according to 1 Peter. And suffering because you work for a public company, one that receives tax dollars from the public, like a public school, a public institution, city government, and you're told to stop and you're told you might be fired is not suffering according to 1 Peter. You are a Christian. And that means that you could be arrested. You could be threatened with violence, or worse, be martyred like Stephen, the story we learned from last week. Do you see the distinction here? It's like the distinction between shame and guilt. Guilt is, I did something bad. Shame is, I am bad. Suffering because you did something bad is very different than suffering because you are bad. Do you see the distinction? And that's why shame is the master emotion. Now, as we've been doing all month long, we've been lifting up definitions that Brene Brown writes about specific topics. And this is one that she writes for the book that we are using for our Bible study. Shame is basically the fear of being unlovable. It's the total opposite of owning our story and feeling worthy. In fact, the definition of shame that I developed from my research is, shame is the intensely painful feeling or experience of believing that we are flawed and therefore unworthy of love and belonging. So why is shame the master emotion? Well, Brene writes, shame keeps worthiness away by convincing us that owning our stories will lead to people thinking less of us. Shame is all about fear. We're afraid that people won't like us if they know the truth about who we are, where we come from, what we believe, how much we're struggling, or, believe it or not, how wonderful we are when soaring. Sometimes it's just as hard to own our strengths as our struggles. It's the fear that we're not good enough. Now, I want to share with you a passage of Scripture that we're all familiar with. But I doubt you ever caught how shameful it is. It is the prodigal son story in Luke 15. It's a story that we all know. The son has a fight with his dad and demands his inheritance right there. And then he goes off and he spends it in dissolute living. So just get that picture in your mind, dissolute living. And so the son, he loses all of his wealth. He's from a good Jewish family, and he's reduced to feeding the pigs. I mean, how shameful is that? So you get the picture here. And then the story says that he comes to himself. And he's thinking, my dad's got wealth. And so what does he do? He begins to rehearse a speech. And so in verse 19, he says, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands. And then in verse 21, he actually sees his dad, and this is what he says. Then the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. What a shame. Why is it the master emotion? Because it's this belief that you are not worthy. You're not worthy because you can't lose weight. You're not worthy because you're not strong enough to defend your family. You're not worthy because you're not a good enough parent, a good enough sibling, a good enough son, daughter, a good enough employee, a good enough boss, a good enough neighbor. You're not worthy because you don't have enough likes on Facebook. You couldn't stop that accident. You're in debt. You've got health issues because you drink too much, you eat too much, you smoke too much, you don't exercise. Or at least that's what you're thinking, that everyone else is thinking. You're not worthy because if your neighbors or your pew mates here in the church know your secrets, then you would realize you are not good enough. Why is shame the master emotion? Because it controls so many of our decisions. And here's the deal. It is contrary to the Bible. Remember what that response was from the father and the prodigal son? For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And then they begin to celebrate. And this idea of worthiness, I mean, it's found throughout Scripture. 1 Peter 1, two chapters before the one we're studying here, says, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope that with the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. And then my favorite, this one is Isaiah 43:1. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. You are worthy. Just like I did with the kids this morning, would you repeat that phrase? I am worthy. Our worth, our worthiness is untouchable. It cannot be taken away. Whatever your theology of the cross, whatever your belief about the life after death, whatever your idea of the resurrection, this is the Holy Spirit shaking loose the foundations. Kind of like that 60-mile-an-hour wind we had last week. This is the Holy Spirit letting us know that worthiness is in Jesus alone. And that means that Jesus came back because he loves you and he loves me. What does Lauren say? He loves you and there's nothing you can do about it. I love how the message written by Eugene Peterson takes these words of John 14. Listen to how he interprets it. Don't let this rattle you. You trust God, don't you? Trust me. There is plenty of room for you in my Father's home. If that weren't so, would I have told you that I am on my way to get a room ready for you? And if I'm on my way to get your room ready, I'll come back and get you so you can live where I live. And you already know the road that I'm taking. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves me. We are guilty. We do bad things, and Jesus still forgives us for those guilty things. His resurrection is a reminder of yours and my worth, and it cannot be taken away. But more importantly, it is bound up in that single act of the resurrection. This is not about who you are. This is about your worth in Jesus. The whole town had gathered in the courthouse for the trial. The prosecuting attorney called his first witness, an elderly woman, to the stand, and he approached her and asked, Mrs. Jones, do you know me? And she responded, Why, yes, I do know you, Mr. Williams. I've known you since you were a young boy, and frankly, you've been a big disappointment to me. You like to cheat on your wife. You manipulate people and talk about them behind their backs. You think you're a rising big shot, but you haven't the brains to realize you will never amount to anything more than a two-bit paper pusher. Yes, I know you. Lawyer was stunned. I mean, not knowing what to say, he kind of pointed across the room. And he says, Mrs. Jones, do you know the defense attorney? She replied, well, yes, of course I do. I know Mr. Bradley since he was a youngster, too. I used to babysit him, and he, too, has been a real disappointment to me. He's lazy, bigoted, and he has a drinking problem. The man can't build a normal relationship with anyone, and his law practice is one of the shoddiest in this entire state. Yes, I know him. At this point, the judge wrapped the courtroom into silence and called both counselors to the bench. In a very quiet voice, he said with menace, if either of you asks her if she knows me, I will hold both of you in contempt of court. Jesus knows you. Jesus knows me. And Jesus knows the guilty things that we have done. And that doesn't take away your worth. You have sacred worth. The resurrection means that Jesus loves so much and there's nothing we can do about it. That's the theology of grace. That's the theology of life after death. That's the theology that shatters shame as the master emotion. Now, it doesn't mean that we're going to wake up tomorrow and everything will be fine. But if we believe that our worth is in Jesus, then maybe our life and the life of those around us will be a little bit better. And when that happens, we've learned a life-changing lesson. Let me end with a quote from Marianne Williamson. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We're all meant to shine as children do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some of us, it's in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. You are worthy. I am worthy. We are all worthy. Shame was introduced into creation a long time ago, and shame is not going away. It controls our emotions. But your worth has been purchased by Jesus, who automatically liberates us. Now, that doesn't mean that it's going to make life any easier. But we can understand it just a little bit better. Thank you for allowing me to bring these quotes and phrases of Brene Brown to your attention. And I hope it leads to a life-changing lesson. Amen. I want to thank our ushers. This is our opportunity to think of the blessings that we do have, the things that we have learned, and to provide to God those things that are God's. Thank you. thank you so much for the blessings that you have granted to us. Sometimes it's hard to see them, but somehow and in some way that Holy Spirit is breaking forth and breaking through. Allow us to give back to you, gracious God, for all these blessings. In your name we pray. Amen. Will you join me in sharing together our benediction? The pathway is open before me this day. It is a path of peace and hope brought to others by God's mighty love and wondrous blessings. I am at peace, bringing hope to all that I meet. I am a blessed one, going to serve God all my days. Amen. Our closing hymn is "It Is Well With My Soul."